behalf of the Executive Committee of the Genesee Valley Chapter, we want to welcome you officially after we wine and dine you for a while. And thank you so much for joining us tonight to celebrate 50 years of GVC here in Rochester. Just to begin a little more festive portion of our program, we're going to turn this over to Gail Squared. It's Gail Wilder and Gail Susie, who are in charge of the game that many of you have just enjoyed.
So you've had a chance to see all the impressive things that many people in this room have done. And we have fabulous prizes. Fabulous prizes. But we need to know who's got all 25. Okay, could you stand up to see how many we have? Three, four, five. Okay, we have four fabulous prizes. So we have some numbers that we picked. So let me get our sheet.
The numbers are between 1 and 20.
Okay, so pick a number.
Four.
Four. Okay, four is the winner. That's a bingo. All right, so that's Linda. Okay.
Six.
Okay, that's not on the sheet. Hold on a second. Not on the sheet. What have you got? 11. Let's see. That's pretty close to 1. So let's
Secretary, I cast my vote for the ballot as it stands.
Thank you, and congratulations to everyone who has just been elected. I look forward to working with you.
You know, a lot of work went into putting this evening together. There was a dedicated group of people, some of whom you've seen here tonight already. But there were certainly two people who were instrumental in making this whole thing happen, who volunteered to take on a whole lot of responsibility for making it happen. And that's Shirley and Jackson Thomas. And as a small token of thanks for what they've done, I'd like to pass this on to them. Business is that as I think most of you know, our winter lodge trip is coming up fairly soon. Bill Schweinfurth, who's running that, lets us know here that there are still a number of slots available. And certainly, if you have any interest at all, please contact Bill at the website that's shown there on the slide and let him know that you'd like to come. As anybody who's been on that trip knows, it's a great time. It's a great opportunity to spend a weekend, a long weekend with people, enjoy some great meals, family style, and to just get outdoors and do all kinds of interesting things. So please keep that in mind. And so tonight is certainly a special night, and we've asked a couple of people to talk a little bit about club and the chapter and a couple of people who have really been involved with the club and the chapter for a long time. I'd first like to bring up Jim Bird, who is not only past chair of this chapter, but also was president of ADK itself. He's got a few things to say. Jim?
Thank you very much. One thing I love about talking to ADK groups is that you can wear your sort of nice slacks and your nice sweater and your hiking boots. So it's great. I do want to welcome you all here and to just point out a few people that I know are here, and I'm sure I won't get everyone, but I'm going to start with Deb Fedele because she's here, and her father was one of the charter members of the chapter. So. Let's have a round of applause for Deb Fedele. One of the land, this is the land. I also want to point out a gentleman to my right, because it's all his fault that I'm up here, and that's John Holtz over here, who was chapter chair back in the early 90s, I think, or the 80s. Yes, he called me one day and went to lunch, and from then, you know, I ended up as president of the club, so be careful if he ever calls you. So let me just comment on a couple of things. I've been asked to speak about my perspective on volunteering at what we call the main club. And I'll just comment a little bit about how I got into that. I never planned to be a volunteer for this club. I started coming to the meetings about 3 years after this chapter was chartered. And I came because I thought they were doing those monthly programs, and they were all adventure stories, people climbing big peaks and everything. And Jack Freeman did one of them. Jack is here tonight. And Tilly, uh, story about climbing Denali, which he organized trips of people without a guide, and they went up not the usual route, a much more difficult route. And I have to say, I was impressed. I was also intimidated, Jack. That was quite a trip. So I didn't have any plan for that. I came to get partners to go on trips, to learn about the Adirondacks, and that sort of thing. My involvement was pretty gradual. John really got it started with regard to any leadership in the club. After I was chapter chair of that for a couple of terms, I got on a committee with Bob Ringley, who was president of ADK at the time, to look at the lodge up in the Adirondacks. And that's where I learned about things like mice really do eat insulation off electric wires. And so you'll be happy to know that all those wires are now in metal conduit. So that kind of got me involved in things. One thing led to another. I was a director here from the chapter, which took me to the board of directors meetings. And from there, I was vice president and then president. So the current president is John Gilowitz, who followed me. So give him your support. I also want to comment that we've had some other people from the chapter who've been officers, leaders in the main club. Judy Minnesota is back here from Oregon. She was the first vice president. I don't know if Don Bennett is here. Don was, in those days, they numbered the vice presidents. He was the third one. So, third vice president, and then Dave Harrison, more recently, was secretary of the whole club. And so, I've been asked to talk about volunteering at the main club. And I'm going to call this ADK Is, and then I'm going to fill in the blanks. So let me just share with you some things that I found out that ADK is. Many of you know this, but some of you may not. Of course, ADK is groups of hikers and paddlers and cross-country skiers and bicyclists and all sorts of other non-motorized recreation. And I'm not going to talk about that because, first of all, it's mostly chapters that do a lot of that. Let me just point out the first thing that I want to mention to you is ADK, I found out, is actually a business, among other things. It's a very diverse business. It's what the politicians like to call a small business. And it has all the wonderful problems and opportunities of small business. Like, we have a terrible seasonal cash flow in this club. We make all our money in the summer, and then we try to spend it all the way through the rest of the year. That, my friends, takes a fair amount of management. And it's working, but it's difficult. We run a hotel chain. Admittedly, it's a short chain. There are two hotels, in fact, but I'll also count lean-tos and tent sites at the campground at Heart Lake. We're also an operator of a restaurant, and we do that. And I'll just comment that, of course, the food is the part that goes in. And then I'm reminded of a day when I was helping with the JBL flying. And I'd been carrying boxes of canned vegetables over to a cargo net for this helicopter to take into our lodge. When I heard the helicopter coming back, and I looked up about 100 feet over me, and there was the helicopter with two 55-gallon drums on a rope. And guess what's in the drums? Well, let's just say it's a service that we provide at JBL in order to protect the resource. But I will tell you that when you look up and you see those things overhead, you very quickly get out of the way. We also run retail outlets, two of them. We are a publisher. We publish maps, books, guidebooks, history books, nature books. We're a travel service and a guide service. I even had the opportunity to do that for the club with some of the people that are in this room down the Green River in Utah a few years ago. One of the things we don't often think about here at the chapter is that the club is an employer. We have about about 40-something full-time employees, and in the summer we go up over 70 employees. We're one of the larger employers inside the Blue Line after New York State and some hospitals, I'm told. We're also a career provider. We have, I think it's safe to say, Neil, the longest serving current employee of the club with us tonight, which is Neil. How many years? 28 years for Neil. And ADK is what you call a matrix organization. For those of you who have ever been managers of something, you know that matrix organizations have lots of opportunities, and they also have some interesting difficulties. And ADK is no different. Moving on, in terms of other than a business, ADK is a school. We're the navigation experts for the Adirondacks and the Catskills. We write the guidebooks. Not all of them, there's a couple, but ours is good. And it's good enough that the National Geographic people came to us for the information when they wanted to do that series of National Geographic maps of the Adirondacks. And so you'll notice our name all over that map, which is good. They got the information from us for that. We also have people who are among the only people in the United States certified to teach Leave No Trace principles. We also teach first aid, maps, hiking, all sorts of things. The third thing that ADK is a construction company. I like to say that we're a transport infrastructure provider. That sounds pretty good, I think. That sounds pretty good. That's called trails and bridges. And we do a regular business in that, the state of New York. We're also in the building renovations business. We do kitchens, we do bathrooms, we do gray water disposal fields outside JBL. And a lot of these things are done in the wilderness area where you can't use motorized tools and vehicles. We also build lean-tos and campgrounds, and we maintain all the stuff I just listed. Another thing you may not have thought about recently is that ADK is a relatively big landowner. As small groups go, we own a square mile of some of the best land in the Adirondacks, a mountain, a lake, and the largest, busiest trailhead in the Adirondacks, actually in the state, I understand. 70-some-odd thousand people going through the Heart Lake Trailhead every year. Another thing you probably may not know is that at one point ADK was a diplomatic arm of the United States of America. And I'll just point out that that was because some representatives of the Altai Republic in Siberia and Russia came over, and they wanted to know how they could do a nature museum on a relatively small budget like ours. And so they took away a lot of ideas from our nature museum in Heart Lake. So that got us into the diplomatic business. But I want to go on, and I'll not be too long. Those are all concrete things, books and bridges and trails and things like that. But to me, they're not as vital, really, as the fact that ADK, to an awful lot of people, is it's an idea, and it's an image, and it's a vision. It's a way for us to believe that we can actually protect some of nature and help us find our fit in nature. That has brought together all these people, I'm told close to 30,000 members now in the club, and that makes us a rather large social group. Neil just told me tonight that we are the second largest conservation and outdoor recreation organization in the United States. That puts us even ahead of Mountaineers in the Northwest, which surprised me actually. We have 26 chapters, and you might be interested that 35% of our members are members at large and are not in a chapter. But all those people, and one other thing I forgot to mention, is those people are doing this because they believe in what the club is doing. They have that vision of what we can do. We are a very highly respected conservation organization in the state of New York. How do I know that? Well, it's not often that Mr. Cuomo's office calls up our executive director and says, "I'd like to go fishing with you for a couple of hours in a canoe tomorrow." And this happened over the exercise of how to deal with the Essex chain lakes when they were coming through. So Neil had 2 hours in a canoe with our governor, and by the way, it was the governor's initiative that it happened, and Neil was brilliant enough not to catch a fish. However, there's another side to this that you see sometimes, and that is that we could be called an interest group lobby. Neil is an excellent lobbyist. And we possibly could even be thought of as a target or an enemy by some people. This came to me recently when I was at the Boreas Ponds hearing here in Rochester, and many of you were there. There are people who take different views on the wilderness than ourselves. So, this vision of protecting lands and waters, that's really, to me, what ties people together. It's what makes some member of this club in Oregon keep up their membership. It's a long way to go for a hike from there. At the same Boreas Ponds hearing I talked about, to give you the idea of support, we had a number of people from this chapter, but there were also people who drove over from Syracuse. There were people who drove over from Buffalo for the night, and they got up and gave their speeches. Well, without the foresight and the work and the vision of the people who got this chapter going 50 years ago, we wouldn't be adding our bit to what ADK does along those lines. What I want to leave you with, finally, is that we need everyone to get involved. Protecting wilderness is a never-ending battle. The development forces on the other side are well-financed and relentless. And when you have 60 million people within a day's drive of the Adirondacks, there are a lot of development pressures. So we need you to do that. And remember, please, what we have at stake and what we sometimes take for granted. I came across this little note. It's a quote from a lady called Iris Murdoch. It has to do, and it uses flowers as a metaphor for everything that we take for granted and shouldn't do. I'll read it for you. People from a planet without flowers would think we must be mad with joy the whole time to have these things around us. Think about what we take for granted and do what you can for the wilderness. Thank you.
Building on what you just said, I'd really like to try and emphasize that what happens in ADK wouldn't happen without the efforts of the volunteers who make events like this happen, volunteers who organize trips, people who organize conservation and advocacy for the club. All of these activities depend upon folks who are doing this because of a sense of commitment to the outdoors, something that I think is what binds all of us together. And that's why it's so critical that we have people who, in fact, help out. Currently, within the chapter, we have a number of tasks that need to be performed. And to be honest with you, there are a number of people who have been working at these for way longer than any of us should have expected them to. And it would really be helpful if, in fact, there were some other folks who were willing to step in and help out for a while. I mean, we're not looking for a multi-year commitment, but on the other hand, to have somebody come in and perhaps help out with the trails program, for example, or help organize our expo in the spring, or any number of other tasks that come up during the course of. Certainly, if you have even just a little bit of time to spare to do something like this, we'd certainly love to have you come and help us out. It's easy to contact any one of us, myself included. My contact information is in the Geneseean, it's up on our website and the like. you have any questions about what it is that needs to be done, what the level of commitment is, please give me or another member of the executive committee a call or shoot us an email, and I'd be happy to talk you through it. And like so many other things that are volunteer activities, they're very flexible, okay? They tend to be defined by people who are doing, okay? It, do not feel that, in fact, you end up taking on a predefined, enormous task. It doesn't have to be that way. So again, I'd ask everybody to think about this, and in fact, talk to other folks that you know within the club. I'm always reminded of the fact that this chapter has 1,250 households. It's hard to believe, and it's a huge number of people, 1,800 members altogether. And yet the number of folks who are actually active within the chapter is really quite small. I would guess something about 100 or so. It would just be great if we had even another 100 folks, for example, willing to pitch in. So again, Jim, thank you very much for those good words and a little bit about the chapter of the club. Neil Woodworth is our executive director. He stole the story that I was going to tell about that canoe ride with our governor. Obviously, a guy who's well connected with folks in New York State who make decisions about what's going to happen with our wilderness. A guy who has been leading our club now for a number of years and has made us quite a force for the outdoors inside New York State. So, Neil Woodworth.
Very warm welcome. Can everybody hear me okay? Great. Well, happy birthday. This is an important one, and this is a very important chapter to the Adirondack Club. It's always, going back through decades that I have worked with people from this chapter, this is, as you all know, an incredibly active chapter, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. But I wanted to give you Jim really gave you an excellent picture of what the Adirondack Mountain Club is. And I thought I would build upon what he told you and just give you some details about where we are today. Now, one of the things that I was with him back in 2004, it's hard to believe it was back in 2004. For many years, I was the club's lobbyist and counsel, and I still am. But in 2004, when my predecessor, Joe Benton, took the only trip she ever did to the Albany office. She came down and sat down in front of me and said, well, I have something to tell you, Neil. I'm retiring. Well, I thought that Joe was in her 40s, 50s, you know, totally unprepared for the fact that she was indeed 65, and she could retire. Well, that was in 2004. The club has been a great pleasure to be the executive director of it since that time. And one of the things that I think that is something I'm very proud to share with you tonight is that Jim Berg was part of the progress that we have made on the club's finances. And there was no question that we did have, over, you know, because of the way our businesses work, we did have a considerable cash flow problem. But a few years ago, the club's leaders had the discipline to take a $650,000 request and basically take half of it and put it into really a permanent cash fund that we try to put forward every year between $400,000 and $500,000 into the new year. And that has greatly, it has made life livable for our controller and his fiscal staff. But a lot of good things have happened for ADK recently, and I'll just give you a sense of that. First of all, we were granted you heard about our Heartway property, many of you have been there. It is the busiest trailhead in New York State. Many of you know, a couple of young people were just rescued, thank God. They were rescued after two nights out in very cold weather. Our property was the rescue base, and we basically gave our trails cabin to the rangers to use as a base for the entire rescue operation. That means that one of the parking lots has to be a helipad, but fortunately, we are able to provide assistance for that kind of thing. And we have a very close relationship with DEC. As part of the fact that it's very much in the state's interest for ADK to be better able to educate the public, to provide the necessities and the things they should have before they go into the backcountry. As Jim said, our whole education department is devoted towards teaching, particularly young people, how to encounter the Adirondack High Peaks, by far the most popular hiking area really in the state. And we are seeing the challenge of that. When last Labor Day, we had 5,000 people on the property. On last Labor Day weekend, one of our summit stewards on Cascade talked to 1,300 people in 2 days, and we had hundreds of people on Marcy and Omani. And we have stepped up to that challenge. We have a $250,000 grant from New York State to improve our facilities at Heart Lake. It will allow us to expand our wilderness campground. DEC can basically concurs with us that it's better to have people camp at Heart Lake, where we can manage waste and the impact that people would otherwise have in the backcountry, in the front country, on our property. And that money is paying for a new well, an expanded water system, an expanded wilderness campground. And most important, and I think that work will be done before January 1st, is that the High Peaks Information Center, the HPIC, is being entirely remodeled. And it's being remodeled to better serve and educate the public. It was it's always been kind of an issue when somebody wants information on how to climb Mount Marcy, and they have to stand behind two people that are buying water bottles or bear canisters or what have you. We have now split that up, that function, so that we can deliver that information better, but make sure that people are good and that they have the right information. Just a few weeks ago, one of my staff members talked a group in sandals and shorts, this was just a few weeks ago, from climbing the track deck. So those of you who know a little bit about the track deck know that we did them a great favor in doing that. Our professional trail group, I think, is the best in the country. And recently, they do a tremendous amount of we do. It's well known that ADK in New York State does the hard trail work. Our programs do. They're the ones who put up an 80-foot bridge over the Neversink River down in the Catskills. They're going to put up. Imagine what that's like to put a bridge with like two telephone poles or stringers and then put decking on, right? 7 or 8 miles from the nearest trailhead, without any power tools. All with young men and women skinning up trees and attaching pulleys and hand winches so that we can put that bridge infrastructure in place. We also are very good at building rock steps up the sides of mountains to avoid the erosion of the vegetation. And we are proud to say that I have just renegotiated our 5-year contract with New York State, taking it from the past total of $2.25 million to $3.4 million. So we will be able to go from providing New York State with 36 weeks of trail work to over 55 weeks of trail work, which is it's over $1 million increase in our 5-year contract. It will also, not only will it well provide for our professional crews, enable them to do a lot more. And we're going from just having a summer trail season now to having a fall season and actually begin to do trail work, not just in the Adirondacks and Catskills, but in other parts of New York State. when our particular brand of work is needed. I'm also very proud of our summit stewards. Those are the young men and women who on the Alpine peaks keep people off the approximately 82 acres of alpine vegetation that includes some of the most endangered plants in the world. And in this new contract, we were able to bump the state's yearly assistance from $20,000 to $30,000. But we've done, with the help of donors and volunteers, we've been able to do a lot more. We have a fund called the 507 Fund, which you know that some stories were inspired by Ed Kepich. Some of you probably have heard of Ed and know him here. But he was the one who was the person who pointed out that we really needed to protect our alpine summits before they were trampled to death. And he was the inspiration for the Summit Steward Program, and 507 is his 46er climbing number. And the 507 Fund, partly through donations, partly through grants by foundations, and partly by the sale of what is proving to be a very popular book called Adirondack Archangels, which is kind of, about 60 people were profiled in the book. I wrote a chapter, our trail, Wes Sandman, the chief of our trail program, and our North Country Operations Director wrote a chapter, John Killian wrote a chapter, Tony Woodward wrote a chapter, and many, many other people. And it's really quite a good book. And so now I can tell you tonight that the 507 Fund has actually exceeded $105,000 in a little over a year, which is enough, basically, just to take the interest on the principal to pay for one more summit steward. So we can cover Cascade next year, beside the regular piece. But this year, the summit stewards talked to nearly 40,000 people in one season. That's really an amazing benchmark. And you can measure their success because we have photographs of what Algonquin and Marcy and Skylight and Haystack looked like then, 5 years ago, and then we've recently just remapped the summits, and we can actually show how much vegetation of that alpine vegetation has actually come back and what species came back. And it's a great way to chart the success of the program. And I'm proud to tell you that this year, we won two prestigious environmental awards. Some of you may have heard of a gentleman, climbed mostly in New England, but wrote several books. His name was Guy Waterman, and wrote several books about the ethics of backcountry travel, hiking, and mountaineering. And our summit steward program, Julia Gorin, who leads that program, received the Guy Waterman Alpine Stewardship Award a few months ago. We also, about a month ago, received, were the recipient of one of seven Department of Environmental Conservation Environmental Excellence Awards. And we were in an interesting company because after ADK received its award, the New York Yankees were called up. And they received the award for completely changing the way they do business at Yankee Stadium. Everything from the recyclability of the hot dog containers to creative ways of reusing the food waste to replacing 3 million lights at Yankee Stadium with LED lights. So it was good company to be in. As Jim told you, we now have 17,346 households as of yesterday. That does bring us up to very close to 30,000 people. And they are spread quite equitably across the state, from the Long Island chapter. We have 5 chapters within the Adirondack Park, or very close to it. And we, of course, have our Western New York chapters that are strong and are healthy. Tomorrow night, I go down to talk to the Finger Lakes chapter at Watkins Glen. And that's a chapter that had been waning in size and number, but has come back. And, and as a good solid membership, and it's going to be a great pleasure to talk to them tomorrow. We've been able to do a lot of this because of we have a great new development director in Catherine Forbes, and she has taken our legacy society. Those are the people that are good enough to commit to leaving ADK a bequest in their will or their estate plan. And she has more than doubled the number of people in that legacy society in the short time that she's been with ADK. And donations by people, the number of people that make donations above dues has doubled since she got here. So that we've had about a 24% increase in the amount of donations. And Jim talked about our advocacy program, and it has been a very busy time for us. And not too many weeks ago, a number of you came to the hearings on the Boreas Ponds and Adirondack classifications in general. Because although a lot of the discussion was about the magnificent Boreas Ponds, there were over 100 other parcels that were being classified at the same time. And this was a really great opportunity to classify wilderness in the Adirondacks. And I remember the last time that we had an opportunity to classify a big chunk of wilderness was Whitney Park, when we bought that in 1996 from Mrs. Whitney, and we had to fight to have it classified as wilderness so we wouldn't have motorboats out on Little Tub Lake and Round Pond, or Rock Lake. And I remember that this chapter was one of the chapters we had a hearing in Rochester, and the turnout for that Whitney hearing was tremendous. And I am forever thankful to this chapter for coming out that night and speaking up for wilderness. And in the recent hearings, there were hearings from Bear Mountain downstate. There were three or four in the Adirondacks. We had one in Albany, but we had a particularly important one here in Rochester. As Jim said, people came from Buffalo. We had organized a bus from Syracuse to Rochester, and organized a bus from Buffalo, but the Buffalo bus never materialized. Fortunately, we had a member of my conservation staff, Paul Gallery. He sent him out there to ride the bus and kind of help people get to the hearing. And he, on the spot, organized a carpool and got every one of those people, didn't miss a one, to the Rochester hearing and back again. We really got our salaries worth that night from Paul Gallery. Those hearings were really very important because we had an opportunity from the approaches to the San Antonio Range and McIntyre West to the approaches to Allen Mountain and really superb paddleable stretch of the Old Placid River to Boreas Ponds itself, almost 22,000 acres, to the Casey Brook Tract that connects the Dix Wilderness with the High Peaks Wilderness. And it does something else very important if you enjoy backpacking. For years, the Blue Trail that went from Elk Lake to Panther Gorge, you had to go a very long distance, 7 or 8 miles, before you could find a decent place to camp. And Panther Gorge wasn't exactly a decent place to camp. But now, the Casey Brook Track is the missing puzzle piece between Upper Osage Lake and the Boreas Ponds Tract. And now, you've got a great place. There are a number of great campsites in that Casey Brook Track. Only 1,250 acres, but very strategically located. And we wanted that stretch, those four parcels together, we would basically add 75,000 acres to the High Peaks Wilderness. And you only get a few chances to add that much wilderness. We haven't had a wilderness increase like that in many decades. And it was terrific to see ADK members all over the state materialize at these hearings. Downstate, I think, was the toughest one because uncharacteristically, we were expecting snow here in Rochester. But downstate at Bear Mountain, we had 4 inches of snow between Bear Mountain and the Hudson River and through it. And so we had kind of an interesting trip back, both ADK and the Adirondack Park Agency staff. But I can't tell you how the Boreas Ponds, what the Adirondack Park Agency will do. I think that the position of a club has a very good chance of being where the final, political calculus is done, and every comment is considered by the Adirondack Park Agency. I think the club's proposal has an excellent chance of being the one that's it is supported by the Adirondacks, working with the Adirondack Council on that proposal. The Nature Conservancy, who knows the land the best, has also endorsed our proposal in a letter to the governor. But there were advocates that, at these hearings that wanted every acre wilderness, and I can understand that approach. We did feel that the people who kayak and paddle should have opportunity to, they'd have to paddle over a mile to get to the Boreas Ponds, but you'd have to get a permit in a lottery system. But we felt that was more protective than any other scheme that was proposed, because we were providing for some kind of a reasonable, sustainable limit on the number of people that would use Boreas Ponds to keep it that very special experience. I don't expect the Boreas Ponds will become a new way of getting into the high peaks. I expect that it will, there won't be new trails that go up into Panther Gorge for Boreas Ponds. I don't expect a new trail that will go up Allen Mountain. I do think that one trail that ADK members prized in the past, a trail up Boreas Mountain that was closed when the Elk Lake property changed hands, the trail that went from the Elk Lake Road up Boreas Mountain was closed. Now we have an opportunity to go from the Gulf Brook Road up to Boreas Ponds at about the 2 mile mark on the Gulf Brook Road. I hope we can reestablish the trail, because it's a magnificent one. We are involved in a couple of other interesting battles right now. I think one of the most interesting one, and it's the only time that the Adirondack Mountain Club, as far as I can tell, ever went into battle with Cornell University as our major ally. And we have a number of tree pathogens: the emerald ash borer, the silex wood wasp, the southern pine beetle that are ravaging our forests. And we have a particularly deadly one called the hemlock woolly-adelgid. And the hemlock is one of the most important trees in the Adirondacks and Catskills. In both forest preserves, hemlocks are roughly 1 in 7 of trees. And they have a particularly important function in the forest. And that is, on the tributaries particularly, this is true in the Catskills, it's the hemlocks, the mature hemlocks, that holds the stream banks together, and the foliage, the canopy of the hemlocks, keeps those Catskill streams that flow into the great reservoirs of the New York City system 5 to 6 degrees cooler than they would be otherwise. And that is enough to prevent the algal blooms in the great reservoirs of Rondout and Neversink, back to Cannonsville and Ashoka. And so this hemlock woolly-adelgid has devastated hemlocks. If you go to Great Smokies National Park, you will see great swaths of dead green trees. And generally, up and down the Appalachians, you will see this kind of devastation. And fortunately, we have, and this is what makes it kind of exciting to work on this project, we have an antidote. We have hemlock woolly-adelgid kryptonite. We have a little bug. It's Latin name, I can never say properly, so I call it, and most other people call it, Little Larry. But Little Larry is a very rugged little beetle that loves to eat the hemlock woolly belgian. And it is a voracious consumer of the hemlock woolly belgian. And because of that, down in West Virginia, where the bug was raised in a laboratory, Virginia Tech and the University of West Virginia, Little Larry was successfully bred in the field and actually saved major sections of hemlock forest. So we have managed to just successfully lobby for $500,000 from New York State to build beetle factories at Cornell. And we hope that by next summer, we will be able to release the first class of 40 to 50,000 little larrets. And we're gonna use them, fortunately, we do not have the hemlock woolly belgian in the Adirondacks yet. But we do have them seriously imperiling the New York City water supply. So we are going to release Little Larry on the most important feeder streams in the New York City watershed. And we hope to propagate Little Larry on a landscape scale so that we can successfully have Little Larry reproduce. We have tested it in several places in New York State, and it can survive 2 or 3 days of minus 30 degree weather. So we are quite sure that it can survive in the Adirondacks. We're also certain from testing that happened out in the Appalachians that Little Larry doesn't eat anything else. So that we're not introducing, to fight one invasive, we're not introducing, you know, another problem. But we think we've got a way to fight back, and now we're looking at other ways, supporting other ways to combat those other tree pathogens. Now, the Genesee Valley Chapter has helped us in a number of places. For many years, this chapter has kept an eye on the West Canada Lakes wilderness. I think Dave Harrison has spent backpacks fairly recently, keeping an eye on that great place. You have a long tradition of looking after Monroe County Parks and looking after those. You do trail work down along the Finger Lakes Trail. And back a few years ago, I should tell you that of all the environmental groups in New York State, the one that has Albany cloud and Albany presence, that looks after state forests, and you know in this part of the state, it's the state forests and wildlife management areas that the Finger Lakes Trail, the North Country National Scenic Trail, goes through. And none of the other environmental advocates in Albany really looks after state forests like we do. And a few years ago, when many of those state forests were being actively eyed for hydraulic fracturing, it was the Adirondack Mountain Club that fought the battle to keep hydraulic fracturing out of our state forests and wildlife management areas, and incidentally also out of Allegheny State Park. In fact, in 2011, we passed two bills through the legislature, and I'll tell you something, passing a bill through the New York State Legislature, it's very easy to stop bills, and we do it every year that are bad, but it is hard to pass a bill and get it signed by the government. And that year, in 2011, we passed two bills that will forever keep Allegheny State Park and Letchworth and Sterling Forest and many other state parks from ever being logged to fund their operation and from ever having oil and gas drilling within their boundaries. And I'm very proud of this achievement, and it was many people from this chapter that helped us achieve it. And because those are battles that depend on voters and constituents contacting their assemblymen and senators to support those things. You do a tremendous job unifying the recreationists and conservationists in this area with your outdoor expo. with 40 groups that regularly participate. That's a tremendous, it takes a lot to organize an event like tonight, and the Outdoor Expo is a very complicated affair, and we're very proud of the Genesee Valley Chapter for taking care of that. More recently, there was a proposal to do some logging on the state forest land around Hemlock and Canada's, and again, you helped us prevent that from that was proposed in a draft unit management plan. We learned about it very quickly from some of you, and we worked with you to ensure that proposal never went any further. You do so many other things well. This chapter has always had a great paddling program. It was one of the earliest chapters to have a wet water training school. And it's always had a great paddling program. You helped us with our Western New York paddling guide when Club put that up. You actively pursued the Adirondack Quest. And I'm really quite proud of what you've achieved with the Young Members Program, with the chapter of the Young Members Weekends at the Lodge. And this chapter, before I came out here, I went through the last 3 years of your chapter newsletter just to get a feeling for the pulse. And you do a tremendous number of outings, you do a tremendous amount of community service, you are truly a chapter where it may seem like only 100 people are doing a lot of the work, and that's probably true, but there's an awful lot of other people that go out and do trail work, that pick up litter, and certainly that come to public hearings to defend what we all feel is very important. Now, we face some challenges. New York State is a national leader in pursuing climate sustainability and in supporting wind power, wind energy, supporting what we hope within the next decade will be a whole group of charging stations for electric cars along the interstates of the state. And we're making great progress. But we know that recent events in Washington may challenge some of those goals that we have here in New York State. During the Bush administration, this organization, when the Vice President, Richard Cheney, wished to basically take the Clean Air Act apart and cancel the acid rain program and cancel the mercury abatement program that EPA was setting forth on, because you can't burn soft coal in the millions and millions and millions of tons that are burned along the Ohio Valley and the Tennessee Valley without producing nitrogen oxide, sulfur dioxide, and a lot of elements of mercury. And when those attacks were made on the Clean Air Act, we went to federal court successfully, twice all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court. And that was quite an exciting time period for me and for the club. And we won all three of those cases. And we may have to in the future, if we start to lose ground in what we must do to abate climate change, we may have to go back to court again, depending on decisions that are made in the next few years in Washington. And I hope that you will continue to support us, as you always have, for conservation, protecting our trails, and protecting the wilderness experience that the Adirondack Mountain Club has come to stand for. Thank you very much.
As thanks for everything the club does for all of us, for all of its advocacy, we'd like to make a small donation to the club. Thank you very much.
We are truly blessed this evening to have 13 of the Genesee Valley Chapter chairs with us tonight. out of the 42 who have served this organization faithfully for so many years. So I'd like to invite, have them step forward here to be recognized. Jack Freeman, Jack, are you able to come over here, please? Doug Smith, John Holtz, David Mundy, David Newman, Jim Bird, Art Brenner, Bill Crow, Mary Warchocki Crow, Rich Sensenbach, Denny Charpentier, Dave Harrison, and of course our current chair, Bill Lindenhalser. Unfortunately, Jack Schrader and Bob Goodwin, who were planning on joining us this evening, were unable to attend at the last moment. These folks are your leaders from this historic chapter.